A woman had a 3-day-long headache. This is what her kidney did to her liver. KC is a 28-year-old woman presenting to the emergency room with a throbbing headache. She tells the admitting nurse that this pain had been ongoing nonstop for at least the last 3 days. 6 months earlier, KC started having massive abdominal cramps that would happen once a month. Doctors told her it was her period, but it would happen at least a week before, and it was the worst pain she had ever experienced in her life up to that point. At an urgent care center, she told the physician about this pain, but they found that her resting heart rate was 165 beats per minute. It was like she was running high-intensity intervals while just sitting there. It was here that she was sent to the emergency room where we are now. Doctors confirmed Casey's heart rate and blood pressure were sky high, but nothing else was wrong. All other tests were normal. This is probably anxiety, maybe a panic attack, they said, as they discharged her with a referral to a cardiologist. Over the next few months, Casey noticed that her hair was falling out in the shower and she lost 30 pounds, but she intentionally wanted to lose weight and was putting in effort to do so maybe nothing's wrong, she thought. At the cardiologist's office, doctors find nothing else wrong. This is for sure anxiety, and Casey just accepted that she has this problem. Over the next few months, KC got married. She went to the gynecologist for family planning. At this visit, she told the physician that these abdominal cramps that she had been experiencing that were happening 1 week before her period kept getting more and more painful. They started 2 years ago, and they really never went away. KC was then 29 years old. In a young, healthy-looking woman, random abdominal pain has a wide differential diagnosis, meaning that it's a long list of problems that could be causing that pain. To someone whose job is to diagnose and treat gynecologic disease, a prominent cause of abdominal pain to them could be endometriosis, but that may need surgery to confirm, and you don't want to do surgery in a 29-year-old if you don't have to. So this gynecologist referred KC for a colonoscopy first to see if maybe there could be some kind of gut inflammation happening, but it turned out to be much more than that. As the days passed, KC was waiting for the scope, and she started feeling that something was wrong. One day, while huddled over in that strange abdominal pain, KC felt a hard mass. It wasn't a lump, it wasn't swollen. When she laid down, she couldn't feel it anymore, but when she stood up, there was a stiff presence in her upper right side, just under her ribs. KC had gotten some blood tests done recently. She asked the doctor there about the hard mass, but they told her that the scope will find it if there's a problem. Maybe I really am too anxious, she thought, but that colonoscopy wasn't even going to happen. At the urgent care, because the mass was getting more worrisome for her, the nurse practitioner feels it once and tells KC, "You need to see primary care or go to the emergency room because something is here." But she had already raised this issue to primary care. They told her that the colonoscopy would find it. This circular reasoning was simply too much as she drove herself back to the emergency room. But in that emergency room, the first doctor told her the scope will find it. But KC insisted, "Please take a look or something." An ultrasound was performed and the technician's face changed instantly when they saw the image. KC was put in for further imaging, and when a second emergency room doctor came back, all the fear, uncertainty, and doubt stemming from KC's concerns would be completely justified. The doctor told KC the hardness in her abdomen were a series of tumors all over her liver, but it wasn't liver cancer because a much larger mass was found on her right kidney. She wasn't having panic attacks, she didn't have anxiety, she had cancer that was growing and spreading around in her body. The kidneys regulate fluid balance. Having a massive tumor inside it can impact blood pressure. With more fluid, the heart could detect that something's wrong and start to beat faster. The increased pressure could also cause headaches, and because the kidneys and the liver are in the abdomen where her pain was, this could be the cause of all of her problems, but it's more than just cancer now because it's not just on her kidney. Something has spread to at least her liver, and what is she supposed to do now? Cancer is a genetic disease. When the human genome was sequenced, we were finally able to have a better idea of what is a normal sequence versus a cancerous one. We've identified many of the genes that get changed when a cell becomes cancerous, but the physical characteristics of cancer are something more. The genes in our body code for proteins, which give us our physical form, but they also signal for our cells to do things. proteins are made of amino acids. Amino acids are sequenced together, dictated by our genetic sequence. Changing that sequence, either by mistake or from environmental damage, causes mutations. But most mutations are harmless and usually get resolved by the body. But sometimes these mutations create proteins that signal to the cell to grow, and there's no signal to stop growing, to keep reproducing with no signal to stop reproducing, to develop their own blood supply, and to survive in the circulation and spread to other distant sites of the body. Inside the kidneys are multiple working parts that exploit natural phenomena to produce normal body function, with urine being a consequence of that homeostasis. In order to do this, different kidney parts harbor a variety of different cells in extreme environments in order to filter wastes out of the blood. And because of this heterogeneity, hetero meaning different, and geneity from ancient Greek genos referring to kind, it means that many different kidney cancers can come out of these highly niche and vastly different cells. Things work as expected in the overwhelming majority of time, but in the instances where they aren't, cells here can acquire those mutations. Based on what Casey's kidney tumor looked like from the images, everything points to an oncocytoma. Oma, from the Latin word tumor, referring to a swelling, and oncocyte referring to the kind of cell inside that tumor that's characterized by an excessive number of mitochondria when looked at underneath a microscope. But something was wrong. In medical literature, renal oncocytomas are well documented to be benign cancers, meaning that they don't spread. Casey has multiple tumors all over her liver, so a cancer has spread in her body. But if renal oncocytomas aren't supposed to spread, then what's on her liver? As doctors go in and take a sample of Casey's tumors to look at underneath a microscope, they confirm the tumors growing on her liver are from the cancer on her kidney. And as they look at the kidney and liver tumors, they find that they all look exactly like an oncocytoma, defying the consensus in medical literature, because while kidney oncocytoma isn't out of the ordinary, seeing that exact same tumor from a liver sample is virtually unheard of. When she learned of this, she started to look online to find out more. Because her case defies conventional knowledge, she could only find information on oncocytomas that haven't spread. And because it's usually benign, the treatment is to surgically remove the kidney. But when she asked the cancer physician if they could do this for her, the answer was probably not. They could remove her kidney, but there were just too many tumors all over her liver. And now that it is already spread, there's no telling if the cancer is in other places in her body that just aren't visible yet. When doctors were taking tumor samples from KC, something had happened. As they went into her liver to collect, they got the samples from a needle inserted into her body, and she was sent into the recovery room. But almost instantly, Casey's body started feeling hot. Her hands started feeling clammy as her field of vision started to turn dark. She was bleeding out into her abdomen. The liver is highly vascularized. A substantial percentage of the entire body's blood is flowing through the liver at any given time. Casey didn't know that she had a bleeding disorder, but this experience exposed that she does. Even without the disorder, when a small needle is present in the liver, there's a chance that it can cause a bleed. And for KC, she had a bleed happen when her liver was biopsied, and because there were so many tumors all over her liver, the medical team told her that surgery really might not be a viable option. As the days passed, doctors told KC that they wanted to start her on a two-medicine combination. This would do a couple of different things. First, these medicines are known to impact specifically kidney cancers and theoretically should shrink her tumors. The second thing that medicine should do would be to decrease the likelihood of micrometastatic disease. You see, when tumors are visible on imaging, there's millions of cancer cells contained within. But there exist tumors that have less cells than that that aren't visible. And we know that cancer cells divide and replicate, sometimes at much higher rates than normal, meaning if they don't appear on the scan now, they could appear on the next. And medicine could target these and maybe eliminate them before they're even seen. The problem is, this medicine combination is usually used to treat a completely different kidney cancer. It's not entirely clear that it'll work for her, and her cancer may be growing somewhere else where they can't see, as Casey went to get a second opinion. Halfway across the country at another large cancer center, Casey was seen by the medical team there. They confirmed she did have metastatic oncocytoma, despite the literature saying that this particular cancer doesn't spread in the body. The medical team at the center knew Kidney oncocytoma can spread, but there were less than 5 documented cases. She was told they want to start her on medicine, a different one from the combination originally proposed to her, but for the same reasons, to shrink her tumor, to try to prevent any further spread, to reduce the chances that more tumors would appear on subsequent scans. And if all this goes well, then surgery could be possible, but at a minimum, this should help prolong her life, bringing us back to kidney heterogeneity. There are so many different types of kidney cancers, but they are still kidney cancer. Any single subtype can have similarities with another subtype because they originate from the same organ, while still having key differences amongst one another. A different kidney cancer can arise from the same or similar cells as oncocytoma. It's called chromophobe kidney cancer because its cells are not colored by the standard stains used to see cancer under a microscope. But chromophobe is well known to spread throughout the body and frequently to just the liver. Surgery to the kidney and the liver has sometimes cured patients with chromophobe, and chromophobe can also happen in younger female patients. Given these two cancers' similarities and that Casey's pattern of metastasis to the liver resembles chromophobe, then theoretically she could be treated with the medicine used for chromophobe despite not having chromophobe, bringing us back to her second opinion visit. The physician here explains to Casey how the cancer can respond to the medicine. It could stop growing and stay stable. It could shrink, but they need time to see. Despite medical literature giving no clear signals on how to treat KC because it says that her cancer doesn't even exist, this inference from the related chromophobe kidney cancer gave a rationale for the treatment choice. In United States medical training across all of the professions, one overarching theme is embedded in the phrase, "If you hear hooves, think horses, not zebras." Casey presented to the emergency room all those months earlier with a 3-day-long headache, with a resting heart rate of 165, a sitting blood pressure of 160 over 100. In a healthy-looking 29-year-old woman with these problems, you hear and see these hooves of problems and you think of the most common horses or issues causing them and take steps to rule the horses out first before moving on to identify the zebra. It's very common for this rule out part to get lost in the shuffle of multiple visits with multiple providers in multiple offices, and this is why you have to be your own best advocate. But on the flip side, medicine can quickly devolve into excess, dragging people into the deepest pits of never-ending hypochondria. In Casey's case, she was the 1 in 100 million case of an ultra-rare kidney cancer that even today is still not fully characterized. When she was experiencing all of this, searching online was no help. All renal oncocytoma mentions were assuming that it's not metastatic because the medical literature was no help, saying that this kind of cancer doesn't spread. Similarly, the internet was no help for Casey when she looked at chromophobe kidney cancer because the resources for that also outlined treatment that maybe didn't apply in her case because she didn't have chromophobe. As she was started on the medicine suggested by the second cancer physician, Casey's tumors were observed to be shrinking in size. The medicine that she received was probably the right treatment at the right time for her particular case, but a couple months into this treatment, Casey started having bleeding problems again. In the emergency room, again, doctors look at Casey's medical record and note that that medicine that she was on can cause severe hemorrhage. Given that she has a pre-existing bleeding problem, this could worsen her situation. The benefit of medicine shrinking all of her tumors was weighed against the risk of her having recurring bleeding. But as the cancer physician looked further, it seemed that those tumors have shrunken to the point where Casey could stop the medicine and be eligible for surgery. At the research hospital, a large medical team were preparing themselves for this rare surgical case, but this was all happening during the height of the global health situation in 2021. The hospital didn't have enough blood for her to do the surgery. If this is delayed, it may be complicated to restart her on the medicine again, and it could allow the tumors to start growing again, and in a way that the medicine won't work anymore. But luckily for KC, when she put an announcement on social media, the local response for blood donations was simply overwhelming as a very large quantity of units suddenly became available for her. And as surgeons go in, KC's right kidney and the visible tumors on her liver were all removed in a 6-hour operation. When she returned home, her blood pressure returned to how she remembered it years ago before this ordeal. No more resting heart rate of someone running high intensity intervals. No more 3-day-long headaches, and no more strange abdominal pains before her period, as Casey was able to regain full function again.
My name is Katie Coleman. I am the real patient, Casey, and I am a metastatic oncocytoma survivor.
Katie is the founder of the Chromophobe and Oncocytic Tumor Alliance, COA. She's also a YouTuber. Check out her channel here. I put a fundraiser tag on this video for COA, and if you contribute, it will be greatly appreciated. I'll help get the ball rolling. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.